So you want to start resistance training, but you're not sure what to do. If so, this video is for you. If not, that's okay, you can still watch. I've discussed previously how maintaining your lean body mass while losing weight may be key to successfully treating obesity long term, and resistance training will help you do this. Additionally, resistance training provides many health, fitness, and physique benefits, and I can personally attest that it has transformed my life for the better. So if you are a beginner to lifting, how should you structure a workout program? That is what we are going to explore in this video. Let's start with some basic terminology. We will use the incline dumbbell bench press as an example. As you can see, my body is at an incline relative to the floor, I am on a lifting bench, and I am pressing dumbbells away from me, so the name fits. This is considered a compound exercise because it uses multiple large muscle groups, including the chest, shoulders, and triceps. For comparison, a triceps extension is an isolation exercise, as it primarily uses the triceps. Here, realize that every time I am performing the movement, which in this case means pushing the weights away from me, that counts as one rep. When I group several reps together and then stop, that counts as one set. I can choose to stop the set when I am still able to perform at least one more rep, or I can do as many reps as possible until I can no longer perform any more reps. If I choose this latter option, then that would be considered training to failure. Individual reps can be performed in different ways. I can vary the tempo of the rep, which describes the speed I perform each portion. In general, whenever you are doing the hard part of the rep, which is against the resistance, this is considered the concentric or positive portion of the rep. When you perform the easy portion of the rep, which is with the resistance, this is considered the eccentric or negative portion of the rep. Additionally, I can choose the range of motion that I want to use, either partial or full, where full range of motion entails the longest path of movement for the exercise while maintaining good form. After I finish the set, I will need to rest for some time prior to beginning a subsequent set, and this is the rest period between sets. After I complete a full workout, I would need to decide how many days I want to rest before completing a subsequent workout. The number of workouts that I complete for a specific muscle group in 1 week describes the training frequency. The number of sets and training frequency help determine our overall training volume, where a higher amount of volume entails a greater amount of overall work. While this is not an exhaustive list of all training considerations, this is a good start, and certainly it is enough for one video. So regarding how many reps and sets you should perform, your rep tempo and range of motion, whether you should or should not train to failure, how long you should rest between sets, and what your overall training frequency should be, let's see what the literature suggests, and I will throw in some practical points along the way. There have been several large analyses evaluating the impact of different rep ranges on skeletal muscle hypertrophy, which describes muscle growth, as well as skeletal muscle strength. In general, what they show is that anywhere within a rep range from 6 to 30 can yield equivalent results for hypertrophy and strength if you go close to or reach failure within each set. How to define close to failure is a bit murky, but being within 2 to 3 reps for lower rep sets and 1 to 2 reps for higher rep sets will likely be sufficient. So how should you decide what to aim for within 6 to 30 reps? For exercises that use your whole body like squats, lower rep ranges may be desirable, as performing higher rep sets can be taxing on your cardiovascular conditioning, and you may not be able to approach the point of actual muscular failure because you will be too out of breath. On the other hand, if you are working out at home with limited access to resistance, you may need to do higher rep sets with lighter resistance to be able to approach failure. Practically speaking, you will probably find that you prefer different rep ranges for different exercises, and at times you may even want to stay under 6 reps to develop familiarity with heavier weight. This is fine to do, and many people make great progress staying with lower rep ranges for the initial heavier compound movements, and then using higher rep ranges for subsequent exercises in a workout. Several reviews have evaluated the impact of the total number of sets done in a week, finding in general that with 3 to 4 sets per muscle group per week, you can make significant progress. However, going up to 10 to 15 sets per muscle group per week will likely provide better results. If you do choose to perform relatively few sets per week, then it is likely more important to push closer to failure on those specific sets. So how many sets should you do? It is reasonable as a beginner to start with relatively few sets, as this will make the workouts quicker, easier to stick to, and allow you to better focus on mastering the technique for each specific exercise. There are a couple of things to keep in mind. First, only your actual working sets count, not the warm-up sets where you are not pushing yourself very hard. Second, you will also want to consider how various exercises overlap. For example, one set of the incline dumbbell bench press will count as one set each for the chest, shoulders, and triceps. If you do want to start with relatively few sets, you can continue this plan until your progress begins to stall, and then increase the number of total sets you perform to stimulate further progression. Several reviews have evaluated the impact of repetition tempo on overall results. In general, what is found is that doing the concentric portion as fast as possible while keeping the weight under control with a slightly slower eccentric portion is probably ideal. Here, it is important to ensure that you maintain appropriate technique and control over each repetition, because if you move too quickly, it may move your body out of position. Thus, aiming for a 1 to 2 second eccentric and concentric phase should be fine. Of note, when you are first learning an exercise, you may want to perform the reps more slowly than this to help ensure you are developing and then maintaining good technique. As you become more comfortable with the exercise, then as time goes on, you can speed up the repetitions accordingly. Additionally, you may find it helpful to briefly pause after the eccentric or concentric portion prior to the next repetition if this helps you maintain good body control and technique with each rep. By now you know the drill. Several analyses have evaluated the merits of using a partial compared to a full range of motion with various exercises. While there is some controversy, in general, the studies find that using a full range of motion may be slightly preferable to using a partial range of motion. We will need larger and longer term studies to help determine a meaningful difference between the two in the long run. But for now, I generally recommend using a full range of motion when you are able to do this safely, as this may also help with improving or maintaining joint mobility and flexibility in addition to increasing muscle size and strength. Several analyses have evaluated the merit of taking sets to failure. These generally show no significant benefits for training to failure compared to stopping a couple reps shy of reaching failure. While mild benefits may be seen at times, training to failure also induces greater amounts of fatigue and creates a higher risk of injury. I generally recommend avoiding training to failure on larger compound exercises, unless you are doing this sporadically to better understand how each rep feels as you approach failure. On a more regular basis, if you want to train to failure for the potential additional benefits, it makes more sense to do this with isolation movements, as these are less fatiguing and carry a smaller risk of injury. Several reviews have evaluated the impact of different rest period lengths and rest period activities between sets, finding in general, beginners are likely fine to rest only 1 minute between sets, while more advanced individuals may need to rest at least 2 minutes between sets for maximal benefits. While several strategies have been proposed to aid recovery during the rest period, such as warming or cooling the muscles you are using, none of these have proven very effective. Practically speaking, you will likely want to rest as long as needed to catch your breath between sets. And if you're doing heavy compound movements close to failure, that may take several minutes. Alternatively, if you are performing circuit training where you do one set of several different exercises prior to cycling back to the first exercise, you may not need to rest at all between sets of the various exercises if you are training different muscle groups with each subsequent exercise. Training frequency has been evaluated by several analyses as well. In general, these show that when the total weekly sets are kept the same, you will achieve similar results if you train once a week, twice a week, or even more frequently. Training at least twice a week seems beneficial compared to once a week when it allows you to include more weekly sets. Other benefits to higher training frequency include allowing you to keep each individual workout shorter, and if you miss one workout, you will have still trained those muscle groups some other time during the week. To summarize, I've created an infographic that includes my recommendations for all of the training considerations we have discussed. You're welcome to screenshot it and save it or share it as you wish. Now let's pull this together into a sample resistance training program. We will keep this very simple, and as I make future videos describing different exercises, we can include more variety. This program includes a full body workout 2 days a week. Each workout, you will do the same 4 exercises: squats, deadlifts, incline dumbbell bench presses, and seated rows. The squats and deadlifts collectively train much of your legs, glutes, and lower back. The incline dumbbell bench presses will hit your chest, shoulders, and triceps. And the seated rows will hit your lats, other upper back muscles, and your biceps. Some muscles are not directly trained, such as your calves and your abs, and you can include additional exercises for those muscle groups if you would like. You can also substitute other exercises for the ones I included. This is just an example. To explain the rep ranges, on the first day of squats, you will perform 3 sets of 6 to 10 reps. This means you want to pick a weight such that when you complete 6 to 10 reps, you are within a couple reps of failure. Importantly, when you first start this program, you will not know what weight to select. Initially, you will want to start very light, so you can focus on practicing good technique. Every time you perform all 3 sets at the top of the rep range, while staying at least 1 rep away from failure, you can increase the weight in the next workout. Most beginners can undergo this type of linear progression where you slowly increase the weight or number of reps performed each workout for several months before progress begins to slow down significantly. So even a simple program like this can go a long way. Hopefully you now have a basic understanding of how to structure a workout program, or if you intend to use a program created by someone else, you should be able to determine if it seems valid or not. There are still several other aspects of resistance training relevant for beginners that we need to discuss, so we will continue this conversation in the next video. I hope you all found this video informative, and I will see you in the next one. Goodbye.